What's up, y'all? Today I'm working on this little effect to make it so this little beam thing here, there is a scan beam thing that appears and scans you. It's like, whoa. And then this guy comes in. So it kind of explains what's going on here. That you're kind of like you set off an alarm by taking the sword. So, ahoy, Salad Dong, what's up, man? So I'm just going to get into doing that. I've got everything set up. Mostly for this, been working on it this morning. Basically what's happening here is there's a story node. Here it is, sword boss. So once you take the sword, it'll trigger this story node, which locks the exits, delays a bit, and then you get scanned, and then it delays a bit, and then spawns that Roz guy, the guy you fight. You chilling? Nice. So yeah, this is how this works. It spawns a story action called Action Scan. You give it the first entity that it starts from, and then the entity that it's scanning, and then the color of the scan beam. That gets all parsed here in this Action Scan, and then a Nim Scan runs the animation part of it, which creates another entity for the beam, which runs a simple little AI mood, which will be used to make the beam hit the player. So that's what I'm working on now, is getting the beam, that triangle shape, so it hits the player and stays on the player and kind of goes up and down. So that's what's next. What's up, Arcane? Oops, not action scan. I want mood scan. So every time it gets into the mood scan and ticks this, we want to like set the scan beam's properties. So it'll have a target. That's like, did I set that? Oh, gotta set that. Okay, so the beam.ai.target. How you doing today, Arcane? What you been doing, man? Target equals dest id. Okay, so now we can get the target. And based on the target's position, we'll flip the sprite over. So e.render.sprite set flipped y. It's gonna be if your position, this is the start, is less than the target's position. Okay, now we're gonna scale. We need to scale Y based on, so we're gonna need some rectangles. Auto. Erect is gonna be erect. Oh man, I'm leaving that. e.render.sprite.getTextureRect. So yeah, that's the actual texture rectangle. Not much, you're tired? Other than that, a lot of schoolwork? Oh yeah? You had some exams. A diploma thesis? Wow. Whoa, dude. That does sound like a lot of work. So when do you graduate? Get erect. All right, so yeah, anyways, we don't need to comment all this that much. The scale Y, so set scale, well, X, now Y first. Scale Y is, so the triangle's height over the height difference between you and the target. Get wrecked. You remember that? You remember that? Oh, that was a while ago, right? To all the E-Rec fans. What's up, Farpoke? What is this, BBC radio show?
Busy schedule at the moment. What we're doing that gadget show and doing that dancing on the TV every week on Strictly Come Dancing. Remember, she wants to stay in the contest.
Sweet, you're gonna graduate in 2 7. Oh, that's only like 6 months away, man. Right? Nice, man. The target wrecked. The entities wrecked over the target. No, the other way around. So the target's wrecked. Dot size dot height over the entities wrecked. Dot size dot height. Let's see if that works so far. They play clips with unintentional innuendos. Nice. I gotta check it out. So it's called Innuendo Radio. That works right. Oh, no, not the tar not the entities, not the target rec size that high. This is the difference. The yeah, so this is the entities position y minus the target's rect y, or target position dot y, and then it's fabs. Oh, innuendo bingo. Oh, that's right. A useless engineer? What are you talking about? There's no such thing. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. That's right. So as I get farther away, it got bigger. Nice. There's so many innuendos in today's stream. It just got bigger. Oh man. Float set scale X. X is gonna be, once again, this is erect size dot width. And this is like, so about half of the target recs. Yeah. About half of target rec dot size dot width. Hey, what's up, Salad Rocket Bunny? Salad Rocket Bunny? Salad Bunny. What in my opinion is an ideal EREC size? I'd say about 32 pixels. Well, at least 6 pixels. Yeah, there we go. Now it's like that was about the right width. Okay, the last thing is to get it so it Oh, we need to do the same kind of thing here. For the e.render .sprite.setAnchor back to 0. And if your position is less than the target's position, then it's 0. Otherwise, it's 1. You know what? That's a really great question, Rocket Bunny. I wondered the same thing when I was in high school studying American history and stuff. Maybe Saladongs has some good insight on this. I don't know. I haven't studied that in so long. Okay, it was right that time, I think, but it wasn't lined up correctly. Oh, this needs to be 0.5, not 0. Right, why? Why? It's kind of crazy. People are protesting like crazy. At least here in the Bay Area. We got parts of my city. Oakland city blocks are just blocked off right now. Kids are protesting it in high schools in San Francisco, saying he's not our president. I've never seen a president get elected and then protest it immediately before. Okay, that was good. You lost 20 euros? Okay, we got everything down except for the SKUX. SKUX. So what the hell is the SKUX gonna be, eh? e.render.sprite.setSKUX. Is this an angle? They elected him? Well, actually, our popular vote was that we voted for Hillary. Cal exit, really? Yeah. I thought there was something else behind it all, though. I remember studying it all in American or in American history and all that in high school. I just got this feeling that it was like the Electoral College was. I don't know. What should the California flag look like? Well, we already got a flag, man. It's a brown bear. Difference between set rotational skew. Oh, it's a rotational skew X, I think. I do this in move shadows. Move shadow. Oh, really? Oh, wow, I didn't know that. Max Q, okay, that does appear to be a degrees. Skew. Here's set shadow. Oh, it is rotation skew X. Okay. So I probably want to use set rotation skew X. I'm pretty sure that's the right one. Let's hope he won't be that bad. Yes, that's the... I do hope so, too. Rotate X rotation angle of the node in degrees, which performs a horizontal rotation skew. Yeah. Okay. The difference between set rotation skew and set skew is that the first one simulates Flash's skew functionality, while the second one uses the real skew function. Huh. The sun will still rise again. Yes. Yeah, right? Here's essentially a roadmap of the first 100 days. Donald Trump's contract with the American voters. Impose term limits on members of Congress. Huh. Wow. Huh. Whoa. Man. Huh. I gotta check this out in further detail. Later on. Your engine is coming along, huh? Keyboard input, linear interpolation. Nice. Yeah, who's your president? So I guess I want to get the angle, the X angle between the two. Points. And are these const refs? Oh yeah. Make these refs. So the angle would be, I guess it would be vec2 of probably the target position minus the entity's position dot get angle. I hope this is it. And then set rotation skew X. Angle? Let's see if this works. Oh man. What's with the Okay, let's do a really long scan time for these so I can see what's going on. So scan duration, let's make that 40 seconds. That definitely didn't work. Oh, the Czech Republic, that's right. I remember you mentioning that. Why did the lights all go out? Okay, it's not rotating. Oh, it is. It is rotating. Oh. Angle equals CC radians to degrees. You're in Geneva? Angle. Which is what? It's like 180 over pi or something. I should use this the I don't like this macro. OpenGL, yeah. Oh yeah. Oh, it's wrong, but it's like starting to get right. So now I just got to get it so this angle is correct. So it's actually scanning the player. Pretty dang curious why. Why the flames are all dying? Yeah. OpenGL state. You gotta like push up the state for it. This is so curious. Rob the Swan, what's up, man? Tessellation? Okay. Well, I can figure out why the lights are going out later. Let's get this angle to work. Massive memory plot problems? Oh man. What's going on, man? Okay, maybe it needs to be like 90 plus. Pi times 180 radians to degrees times pi times 180. You run out of memory? Whoa. Well, hey, there you go. Yeah, once you get that fixed, you won't have some the slowdowns either. Nice, man. That's kind of exciting. Yeah, there you go. Okay, that wasn't it. It's not pi times 180. Angle times pi. This is pi. Is that 180 divided by pi? That is. It is. This is totally wrong. Pi times. This is not pi times 180. It's 180 over pi. Sometimes those guys. All right, man. Well, good night. Thanks for stopping by, and good luck on finding that problem and fixing that memory and slowdown. Cheers, man. Okay, good. Now it's doing the same thing it was. Which makes me think that it might. So if I go. It's kind of. Let's add 180 degrees or 90 degrees. Now it's like, it seems right, but it's like opposite. Maybe it needs to be negative 90? You can tell I'm really good at trigonometry. Not. I just totally guess. When it comes to most mathematics, in video games, I just kind of guess. I remember learning this at one point in school, but I don't remember that stuff anymore. Okay, minus 90. Hey, look, it does look kind of right. It's just upside down. Another guess here. Enough guesses and eventually it'll just work. Either that or I'll just take my time-honored solution of taking a break, coming back to it later. That always works too. Okay, that's not it either. The minus 90 was really close. Now it's just like flipped Y, actually. Maybe it just needs to be flipped Y like that. Wow. Yes! Oh! Nice! It's the right angle! Oh, except for here. Oh, okay, I'm starting to understand. Okay, so this is all based on this. If you're above the target, set flip Y true. And set the anchor point greater than, it's gonna be zero. So this is back to anchor middle bottom. Otherwise, flipwise false. This is anchor middle top. And here, we do angle equals negative angle, angle plus equals 90. This one, I think, is just plus equals 90. I don't know. Minus equals 90. Getting closer. Okay, so this is now opposite. That needs to be the. We need a little bit of. This might need to be minus 90. What's up, Kavarni? Okay, so it was minus 90. Oh, this might be it. It's the WTF method. It doesn't work the first time, WTF. Possibly killing all those flames. Yeah, it works both angles. Okay, except for when it's like this. Why does it get all weird? What's going on there? It works if you're like here. Then you start rotating more and more and more and more, and it just gets really, really weird. What is this? It's a little scanner beam thing that scans you when you first take the sword. You take the sword, the scanner beam scans you. And realizes, oh, you're an intruder or something. Okay, so the skew angle It all depends on the angle. If the angle is like greater than 45 or whatever, if it's in a certain range. Both these are negative so far. My weight might be different. It's half of the target rec's width. So that's the target rec is the player. So it takes the player's actual sprite's width and then multiplies it by half, because half of the player is like transparency, you know, the edges of his arms and his sword and all that. There's like half of it about approximately that you don't want to see there. If I turn this to 1, you'll see the beam will just be slightly wider. So yeah, I think how it needs to happen is it needs to use a rotation Y, or it needs to actually rotate itself. Oh, maybe I'll just rotate it. Yeah. See how it's a little wider? And if I take the sword in, out, it's even wider. It's kind of cool, actually. I might leave this. See, it gets really weird if you go all the way over here. But what's crazy about this is it doesn't. So I would just want to rotate it 90 degrees and then apply some skew. Okay, let's start doing that. With the angle. Yeah, Orshi, it does seem like that, doesn't it? But this is what's working. If somebody's like a mathematical genius out there and you want to help me simplify this, please let me know. I'm not a math genius. This is how I code. It's seriously the WTF method. I just code it and then go, that didn't work. Let me try something else. So what I'm gonna try next is I'm gonna rotate it 90 degrees if the angle is in a certain region. I want to turn off render verbosity. I already did that. Okay. So I want to turn off story verbosity. And I'm going to show the current angle at all times. And then just debug alert. Stream format. Okay, so here's the angle. It'll be shown at the bottom of the screen. Okay, so this is 180. This is like 90. Wait, I want to see the angle before I apply any changes to it. So we'll do angle before. You think you know why? So the angle is... Before angle, there we go. So that'll show both the angles. Negative one. What? What did I do? What? Oh, this is there. Not radians. We want to see degrees. Okay. So the original angle here was negative 90. It became 180. This is 0. This is 90. Huh. Okay. Here's something that's that could be tried. Before I do this rotation skew thing, let's just try rotating it. Rotating it will be really, really simple. Because that's just the rotational angle. So we'll do rotation of before. Might need to add 90 or something like that to this. What's up, Eves? Scaling based on Euler distance? What's Euler distance? See, that's like a lot easier to deal with. But now I just need to make it like minus or plus. Or not scaled. What is Euler distance? What's up, Henko? Oh, the straight line distance? Okay, so should it scale y based on the straight line distance? Huh. Or she the intended functionality. So yeah, the intended functionality is I wanted to this beam. This beam comes out of this thing, right? And scans the player. So I want the beam to touch the player and it'll scan up and down. So it'll go from his top of his hat down to the bottom of his feet and then back to the top of his hat. And the whole while, I want the bottom part of the triangle to be flat, right, with the player. So that's why I'm using a skew angle. I want to skew it so that it ends up. Well, let's take a screenshot and I'll show you what I mean. Your beam isn't long enough. So I want it to approximately be like this. I'll do it above the, well, no, let's do it right here. Oops. Man, this could be easier if I just did single lines, huh? I could just cast some rays. This really isn't that hard. I could do a single pixel, stretch it out, cast some rays, make sure they all end up vertically at the right positions. That could be way easier than trying to do this whole stretching a triangle. Basically, it'll look like that. Only they will be behind the player. This is the innuendo stream. Gosh, man, this would be so much easier just to do it that way. I'll take a single pixel. I'll stretch it really tall on the Y. And yes, I will need to use the Euclidean distance, or the distance of this vector here. And I'll do one line for each one pixel of the player. So it'll be like, you know, a line there, a line there, a line there, a line there. That will actually be better because, as if you saw before, there was a part of the triangle that wasn't visible sometimes. So yeah, this could be way easier. Okay, so I'll start with making the parent of all these lines an empty pixel. Tie the beam to something under the hero position. Well, if I were to still use a triangle though, it would be difficult to get this end of this beam to be flat. Besides, if I'm using single rays, this could look cool because I could make parts of the rays like more transparent and less transparent, and that'll make it look more like actual beams of light. Okay, so I'm gonna do it this way. This way I can understand too. The other way, it was really hard for me to understand. All right, so the scan beam. Where is it? Oh, that's story. I want to be in entities. Oh, here it is. Okay, the scan beam is going to start with an empty ping. And the scan beam is going to have a bunch of children that are single pixels. Actually, I could just create this with data and do like maybe just 8 or something. You should have been recalculating 2 points of the rectangle in relation to a center Y coordinate. Recalculating 2 points of the rectangle. Which rectangle? In relation to a center Y coordinate. Huh. Well, that does make mathematical sense, it seems like, but I'm not sure if that made sense as far as the game engine I'm using. The game engine I'm using, it only had a rotation to apply to rotate the sprite and stuff like that. So anyways, this will be a lot easier. I think it actually would be pretty easy if I take this and give it like 8 children or something like that always. Like, how wide is the player approximately? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Nah, we'll create these at runtime. Then we can do more or less. Okay, so we're gonna get the destinations wrecked. The dest wrecked. It should be target. Yeah, it's going to be fine. It's going to be fine. It's only a single pixel stretched out. And besides, it's only like, 10 rays or whatever. So desrect is dest.render.sprite.getTextureRect. All right, so the number of rays we want is going to be the desrect.size.width times probably half of that, but let's do 707 square root of 2 times that. And we want to L round. No, we'll do CLF. CLF that. So that's how many beams we want. So we're going to create all these children now. For int I equals 0, I is less than n, plus plus I. Okay, so we want to create a new entity that's a child of the parent like that. Could just make a scan ray. Create a scan ray entity. This will have a pixel. Okay, so now we'll create a bunch of those entities. Entity E, I guess, works here. We want area.auto entity scan ray. Pause, source.position.pause, e.name, we want it to have a name so it can have a parent. Scan ray. We might as well give the scan beam a name too, just in case I ever want to refer to it. All right, so we got scan rays. Now, scan ray dot name dot parent is going to be the beam dot ID. Mm-hmm. It'll have a position, it'll have a render component, and it'll have a name. And I want it to be deleted. Area dot delete entity. E.id after scan duration plus fade out duration. And we want to set the color too. And the Z order offset. Okay, so now we should have a bunch of different pixels all set up. Little scan ray pixels. Next, we'll just do the math in the update for the AI. We'll just make sure I did everything right here, though. So it deletes the main entity, the scan beam. And it also deletes the scan rays. These are individual entities. They're not children. They're not direct like render children. So if the parent is invisible, it won't affect them. Okay. So now we want to go for each one of these rays. We're going to set a rotation angle and a scale based on the Euler distance or whatever. Okay. So we need a vector of Eids to get the children. We'll call this Eids. Okay, so this is name component find all. Actually, yeah, we can give it a name here. Nah, it really doesn't matter. String parent id is e.id. So that'll get all the entities which we've created that are scan rays. Now we just loop over them. Set ray properties. So for each id, if it's definitely got a render component, okay, so it needs scale y. It's going to be the distance between. Okay, so we need an exact point for the endpoint. So I need to basically get. We know this point right here. That's pretty easy to get. That's the source position. And then we know this very bottom point of the player right here. So now we just need to take this bottom point of the player and add the current Y. Based on, so we want the scan beam to go and like start at top and go and then up again. So it'll, yeah, so there'll be a Y factor in here and then an X factor based on the number of rays and the current ray index and the step, I guess. So we'll have a step and we'll have a current Y. So the current Y is based on the EAI timer. And the timer, we need to know the total timer to be able to get half of it, but let's just not worry about that so far. So float Y is, let's get a percentage. This will be the percentage, the Y or the Y percent. We'll just say for now it's half. This will be based on time eventually. Yeah. Okay, so the float, the actual Y is the Y percent times the target rect dot size dot height. Maybe times like a factor too. Like, yeah, actually, let's do that. No. Let's leave it off for now. Okay, so that's Y. Now the X is going to be based, so we'll do an X step. X step is however much width we want to cover divided by the number of eids. So that is, once again, like about a square root of 2 times target rect dot size dot width over eids dot size. And if we don't have any children, just return prevent any memory or math errors. Okay, so now we got the Y, the X step, the angle, We're almost ready to do this. You had a dream last night? You're at the stream and everybody was speaking Russian? Ah, that's cool. I don't know any Russian except for da. I know da. Niet. That's all I that's pretty good though, right? It was useful. Sure, I hope that would be useful. Oh, we also need the distance. So, the distance from this point to that point or whatever. So, oh, yeah, we'll get the point. Oh, this distance is going to be different for each one. Okay, so, vodka. Oh, I know vodka, right? Yeah, vodka. Everybody knows vodka. This is the destination position, so back to dest. Yeah, we can call this dest. That is target dot position dot pause dot x minus. Maybe best not to do minus. Let's do a float x percent. X percent will be minus a half to plus a half. So we need to go the number of eids. Let's do that. Eids.size is in. Yeah. Yeah, totally, right? Right, totally. But the trick of all that is how do you get a triangle which appears to the game as just a texture, right? So in the game it's just a triangle that's like literally like just like this, right? That's what it looks like in texture memory. How do you get that to stretch and skew and scale so that it's all perfect in that way and with its bottom angle always being flat like that? It's a tricky ass thing when you're dealing with an engine that you're not exactly sure how it all works underneath the hood. You know, Cocos 2DX surprises me a lot, especially with rotations and skews and all that. So you might have the math perfect, but you don't quite understand something perfectly with how the engine translates that into a sprite on the screen, even. Anyways, it's a lot simpler just to do these rays. But yeah, you had a perfect understanding of the problem. Totally. The mathematical problem, for sure. Yes, you can draw primitives. You can draw primitives, but the way that it does primitives is exactly the same as it does other stuff. So even if I had used a primitive, the sprite would be it would act a lot like a sprite, where you'd have to just apply a skew, rotation, and all that, scaling, all of that kind of stuff. So yeah, the draw primitives feature is really not that primitive. It treats it exactly like nodes. Pretty sure. Could be wrong. So x percent is going to be negative a half to positive a half. So that's going to be the current id, which would be float I. Every time we do one of these, we increase I. X percent is, oh yeah, so it's just going to be I over N minus 1. Minus a half. Yeah. Okay, that's our X percent. So target.position.pause.x plus the X step times the X percent. And then target.position.pause.y plus y. Okay, there's our destination put the point, the end of the ray. So now we need the length of this vector. So that would be float length equals vec2. That's going to be the destination point minus the start point, which is e dot position dot pause dot just pause dot length. Okay, now we got the length, so we're ready to set the color and everything. Oh, we already set the color, right? Yeah, when these got set up, we set the color. Okay, so it's ray.render.sprite.setScale. I'm waiting for the autocomplete to verify that I'm coding right. Come on, there we go. Jeez. Set scale Y to be length. Actually, I'm kind of curious about the draw primitives now. What's up, Boogie? What's up, Iron Kogan? The X point is the center. See, the X plus step, it goes from the center to the right. No, that's why I did. That's why I did. X percent is 0. Is negative a half to a half. This is the range negative 0.5 to 0.5. Okay. Oh man, I'm so curious about the draw primitives. Because this kind of would be neat to start using them for something like this, especially for array. Yeah, I think I already accounted for that. But I could be wrong. Might have to go back and do that again. So is there a draw primitive? What is this? Draw primitives, draw poly. Oh, so there's a whole class for this? A namespace. Huh, this looks pretty dang simple. A lot more simple than stretching sprites. Well, that's what it seems like at first. Hold on, okay, so I would have to init this. Let's check out this code. It already has a lazy init. Which just caches its shader. and some shader variables. Okay, so you don't even need to call init, it just calls lazy init. Draw line, shader use, set uniforms for built in, uniform, vertex attribs. Oh, okay, this would have to be done inside of draw call. Okay, I'm gonna earmark this. Think about doing this perhaps later. I'm gonna keep doing it with the sprite method for now. Well, I don't want to make the beam backwards, so. But if you were to, you would just have to flip all around the math, I guess. Okay, so we got the scale Y length. Rotation is going to be the angle. So we no longer need this angle. We're going to have a different angle. So we need to save this vector. We'll call this vector V. This desk minus the start, the source. So that's the length. Angle is V dot get angle. It's a potato ideas. All right, so the angle like that, and then we'll make it degrees so we can rotate. Ray dot render dot sprite dot set rotation. Angle. I'm sure that we're gonna have to mess with this math. This is probably gonna be wrong. Let's show the angle of the first one though. So if I is zero, we'll show this angle. So yeah, we just got the length of it and the rotation of it. I already got the color. So this should be enough to start it. Oh, okay. So you're trying to say the idea you were having earlier. Oh. Go, run, render, play. Okay, so the angle's probably gonna be wrong. Okay, yeah, all right, good, we gotta start. Just gotta get this angle looking better. Awesome, that's better than I thought it would be. Okay, so I'm thinking maybe let's start with just WTF method here, angle plus equals 90. I think the X step is too little. Once again, the angle needs to be like negative or something. Oh, victory. Yes. All right. Good. We got a good thing going here. Now I just got to work on getting it so the width at the end is correct. Which I'm curious why it's not. Because we got an X step. Let's set the X step a little higher. Let's see if the X step was a single pixel, what that would look like. All right, this is cool. So once this is all like mathematically sound, I can start playing with the fun stuff, like making it flicker and making it scan up and down and changing the color of the player and stuff like that. Huh, it's still not really that wide. What if we're two? 2 pixels. Maybe I did this math wrong here with the X destination. X step times X percent. I over N. What's up, Slash Life? Still not really. I over N minus 1. Gonna set a breakpoint. Yeah. Did I do pixel art some month ago? Yeah, totally. I was doing pixel art for this game months ago for sure. Okay, so, all right, we got I 0, N is 12, X steps 2. That's the X percent should start at about negative a half. Where's the X percent? Yeah, negative a half, good. And so that means the destination X, target pause dot X plus, what's the target's position X? Thanks, man. Thanks, Slash Life. Appreciate it. So it's about 196. So the destination X should be like 190 about. Oh, see, it barely even moved it. 196. Yeah, it took away like 1 pixel. Negative, so the X percent is negative a half. Oh, it's per. Oh. So, oh yeah, we don't even need X step anymore. This is just width. Or half of the width, basically. Basically what you were saying earlier, Irokoken. Just the width over two times right here. So let's go. Well, let's set up a width before, so W2 is going to be like something times a half times the target rect dot size dot width. Why did I pick C++ for Songbringer? It's not a meaningless question at all. C++ is one of the fastest and most portable languages out, especially the most portable languages out there. So C and C++, both of those can be compiled on just about any platform. Which means that when you go to Android, you can compile it there. When you go to Nintendo, you can compile it there. When you go to anything, any one of the consoles or like desktop systems you're going to be using or mobile, It's all going to be compatible with C or C++. So, and there's so many great compilers out there for C and C++ as well, so you can get wicked fast compilation. It's just, those are the two biggest reasons right there. Yeah, it's working! It's working! Alright, so it's got a good width. Okay, now let's get it to go scan up and down. It doesn't compile that fast, which sucks. But once it's all compiled, it's pretty fast. Oh yeah, and lightweight executables too. Mm-hmm. And other than that, I really know C++ the best. I know it better than any other languages out there. Well, yeah, of course it depends on what you're doing, but for video games, C++ is one of the best languages out there as far as speed goes and portability. Yep. Yeah, you don't need redistributables, you don't need software to make your game. You can just make your game with code. There's a lot of advantages. You're not locked into anybody's API either. You know, like if like C#, for example. C# is a great language, and it's an awesome language to write games in, and it's got higher level features than C++, which are all advantages. But the disadvantage is you're kind of locked into how you're locked into either using monogame or XNA or whatever. I don't know. Oh, you're talking about lightweight. Oh, yeah. Yeah, totally, totally. If you're using somebody else's framework or whatever, yeah, you're going to have huge binaries. Especially if you're using Boost. Oh, Monogame replaces XNA? What's the other one, though, that uses C# besides Unity? C++ does require redistributables on Windows, but only if you're compiling it that way. You can compile your binaries with Visual Studio to not require that. You can compile them statically, so they don't require the redistributables. Okay, so yeah, scan up and down. We need to know not only the timer, but how I can set as vector. Okay, let's do that. So the vector will be the original timer. Beam.ai.timer is scan duration. Beam.ai.vec.x equals scan duration. So we're gonna stash the scan duration also in the vector.x so we can know what is the total time. Okay, so the Y percent, let's do a total percentage. So float, just percent. Percent, percent equals the total or the current e.ai.timer over e.ai.vec.x. And then the Y percent will be, so we want the Y percent to go from 1 to 0, and then 0 back to 1. So it'll be abs, fabs, percent, minus 0.5, right? Times 2? I think that's right. We'll see. Is there? There's a bunch of alternatives. Oh, okay. What's up, Ragathian? Nice. That's cool. Oh, it's working. It's just that it's scanning for so long. It's like 40 seconds or whatever I got the timer set for. So that's why it's going beer really slowly. Nice, I did the math right on the first try. Once this has a sound effect, it's gonna be pretty cool. Oh, the source position needs to be a pixel higher. Yeah! So happy I was able to beat this guy up. Okay, good. We got a good thing going here. Let's delete this old stuff. Don't care about this triangle anymore. Don't really need any of this other stuff. In fact, I'm gonna check this in so far. This is a really good start. Scan beam, scan ray. Get the rays. Move the rays. Create the rays. Oh, we just want to change that store that scan duration in the story system to be only 4 seconds, and then it's ready to check in. Let's see it with only 4 seconds too. What's up, Cyred? Red 22, what's up, man? Connor 64 games. It's cool. Commodore 64. Remember that big ass keyboard? Whoa. That was weird. Went too high. Oh, because the player had to sword out. Okay. Let's fix that. So the Y percent, let's do only 707 times that. And let's make all these kind of flicker a little bit each time. Ray.render.sprite.setOpacity, something random. Oh, you're right. Yeah, thanks, Sarah Kogan. We take that a half out right there. Cool. Good change, man. So let's go DRANDF. Or we can do DRAND. Modulus. Let's do like, it's maybe like 128. Oh, I got it. Oh, we could always make this half of the beams like less opaque. So if I shoot, now we need to I to be an integer. No worries. Make this here float. Redner, we don't need this anymore. Okay, so if I is even, then we start with the base of, say, 64. This is getting too long. And then we add a little bit, so like DRAM, maybe 32. Red render. Yeah. Yeah, what are some of the new stuff with Oh, that's a good point. Yeah. See, they do kind of look weird. It's really weird at the end, it goes straight up. Wonder what that is. Yeah, you're right. So they do overlap a bit. Let's start by using a few less rays. Oh, at the very, they're supposed to all go invisible once it's done. Oh, yeah, okay, that's what's going on. Oh, let's do that, let's fix that right now. So once the, once this this thing is done, it needs to loop over its children. And make them all invisible. Actually, shit, let's just do it. This is easier if we just do it all in the same loop. Ah! Ah! We'll see. So if timer end, mood sleep, and throwing this all into the same loop, timer is end, the entity becomes invisible. All right, Kavari, see you, man. Okay, so let's see how this looks now. And make sure it doesn't do that weird thing when it gets to the top. Nice. That looked all right with fewer rays too. But I kind of liked it better when it looked more solid. I want to make sure it lines up with the timing of it all. So that fades in, it does this beam. Yeah, okay, the timing worked good as far as the overall beam. But one thing we need one more pixel here where it's creating these entities. Well, that's a V3F up probably. This is going to be really fun once this, I make the sound effect. Like, I'm imagining something kind of like Super Metroid. As usual, one of my favorite video games ever. I'm using its inspiration. Oh, that's weird. It goes behind. Probably because the scan beam... Oh, wait, no. The parent of the scan beam... Actually, no, let's just do Z-order offset here. Is like plus one, always. And let's make it have a bunch of beams again. Really like that. And definitely gonna go with Irokoken's suggestion here to use more opacity or more transparency rather than less beams. So since there's so many beams and they're all overlapping, you probably need to make it fairly low opacity, like maybe even like 32, 48 or so, plus DRAM 16. That would be a maximum of like 64, 63. Cool. Just the width was a little bit too much, though. So the width is kind of like based on the current, right? So the width... Yeah. Let's make this only half. Oh, and I want the targets also to, we want to set the target's color. So this will take the player and make him all flashing and stuff. And here's where we can really mess with the actual opacity. Now, we can't really mess with the opacity. We can mess with the color being not as... Yeah, so we want to go target.render.sprite.segColor. We can apply a tone to the color. So if it's brighter, it'll be closer to white. White indicates that there's basically no change to a sprite. And then if it's fully black, that means it's all black. And if it's red, it just means it's, you know, making it more red than it would be. So we want to apply a tone to the... We did change the color, right, of the parent? We didn't. I should, though. Beam.render.sprite.setColor. Even though it's invisible, it's an empty sprite. So now we have the beam's color, e.render.sprite.getColor. And we can apply a tone like of, randomly between like one, let's say 1.0 plus drandf01. So I'll kind of make him flicker. See what happens there. And I probably want to fade that out at the end and fade it in at the beginning. So if the percent is like less than a quarter or greater than 0.75, it'll fade in and out the color here. But let's see what this looks like now just with a bunch of flickering. Yeah, so it's really too red. So we can go auto target color equals e.render.sprite. No, we'll do a color mix. Ah, that'll be so much better. Yeah, yeah. Okay. Color mix. Mix. We want to mix the white, basically. Mix white with this color of the beam. The alpha is going to be, so if it's, it's going to be percent minus a half times two fab of this. So that'll take it between it's just like the Y percent. Let's just use Y percent. So if the Y percent is greater than a quarter, yeah, we'll do this, some special math here. So Y percent greater than like 0.75, then it's going to be one minus, this is getting pretty long. We'll go color percent. So 5% is greater than that. It's going to be that minus Y percent over a quarter. Is that right? So if it's like 0.75, then it's going to be 1 minus 0.75 is 0.25, where 0.25 is 1. Yeah, but if it's like 0.875, that'd be 1.875 is that over 0.25, which would be about 0.25. Yeah, okay, or half. Nice, that's correct. Okay, so now we need the other part of this, which is if the Y percent is less than that, then we just want the color percent to be 1. Or 0, wait, no, or 1, yeah, 1. We can add some randomness to this so that it randomly kind of flickers. So we could do 1 minus, say, like a half times drandf01. There we go. So that should fade it in and out nicely at the top and also flicker it during the middle. Almost done with this. Just gotta make a sound effect. And fix whatever the hell's going on where it kills the lights. I don't know what's going on there. Yeah! He's flickering a bit. Oh, he turned red at the end. Why did he turn red at the end? And he was a little too red the whole time. So 1.0 would be fully red. I guess we could just make this half. Man, it won't be as red. Use percent. Nice, that looks good. Yeah, stops. All right, that looked pretty good. But I wanted it, the reason I'm using Y percent is I want it to go back up, and I want it to fade out and fade in, and Y percent's already set up for that. Let's try a little less color. Nice. That was a little too little though. So 0.25 is too little. 0.5 is kind of a little too much. Maybe like 3.5. 3.75. How can Y percent be negative 1? No, Y percent can never be negative 1. No, Y percent can never be negative 1 because I'm using fabs right here. See, so the percent is 0 to 1. Here, I'll even clamp it to make sure. Clamp FO1. And then it's fabs right here. So this is 0 to 1 and then minus a half. So that would be negative a half to positive a half. But then absolute value of that, so it's positive a half to positive a half, times 2, so it becomes 1 to 0, once again. Good night, Slash Life. See ya. Okay. I think it's pretty good. It's pretty good for now. I'm going to try to figure out what's up with the fire, like, going away. Why is it just that the fires just all die at the same time? I don't know why. So I'm gonna check this in. This is pretty good. I like how the way this is scanning so far. Okay. Now, how can I debug the situation with the flames dying? What would cause them to die? It might be the filter flow. Or when it... I guess I'll just set a breakpoint. When it ever it kills something. What's killing you, flames? Why are you dying? And why is there like a flame noise right at the beginning every time? There's like a, it sounds like there's fire. Something just caught on fire. What was that? What? Nothing died? So cool. I love this effect with it being scanned. And it's all flexible and stuff. It could be used for any character. Jib could get scanned in some story sequences. Jib just died right there. So, okay, they're not dying. Let's get some audio cues. Why are the... What's going on here? I plan on reusing this old scan beam thing in multiple places. Like, it can get you into levels. Oh, I can't wait to make this sound. You said scans bad. Jib needs that too, right? Jib should have this ability. Do some scanning. Okay, there's something that destroys a light. Light? Fade light? Fade light? No. Scale light? Shrink light. I think it's called shrink light. There it is. Okay, what is causing the lights to shrink? Jib's gonna be jealous. Maybe there should be a time where Jib gets jealous. He's like, your scanning technology is better than mine. Oh man, this is really still bugging me that it doesn't have a sound effect yet. What? Nothing shrunk the lights? Now it shrunk the lights. What? Okay, what entity is dying now? Jib. Oh, just Dib. So it wasn't even it's not shrinking the lights. Wait a minute. Is it the scan? Action scan? What if we don't even do this action scan? Put Jib's... Yes, yes. All right, good call. Something, that's totally bugging me. So we need to do it at the beginning when we call a NIMS scan. We'll give it the scan beam. Where do we create this scan beam at? Here. Okay, so we need a profile. Scan beam sounds, scan, and we'll call, what is it? Jib, what is your sound effect called? Huh? Jib, scan. He's got a bunch of them. Look at this. Ah, where'd they go? Jib scan. It's got a lot of them. Yeah, it's not, I don't think it's relevant to this particular situation. That's probably just kind of a misnamed function type thing. It's, yeah, it's not that clear what's going on there, but I think that's okay. So we got scan sounds. We should be able to call the scan beam, beam.profile.playsound, profile.playsound. Scan. I think that should have a sound effect. And that's great, because now it's all set up, so when I do create the sound, which hopefully be in the next 10 minutes or so, I'll at least get the sound effect started. What? Oh, I skipped the action. Oh, and it still killed the light, so it wasn't that. It's not this action scan that's causing those lights to die. Oh, it could be the action spawn, though. Because there's just, it spawns the... No, but it doesn't spawn him till later. His sound effect is so short. It doesn't really... It worked, though. At least it played something. It's happening right when the lock exits finishes. Lock exits? That was kind of funny, right? It's just like, meow, meow. Lock exits. All right, what if we don't do this? Ah! Still did it! Okay, it wasn't that. What about action spawn? It could be the spawn. These lights just don't want to live. Nothing. Okay, wait a minute. What if we don't even run this the story action? What if we already ran this story action? Yeah, scanning sound inspiration. Yeah. Nice. That still did it? What? Does this happen to other lights? They did. Oh, all the fire is dying. The fire of the world, the lights are going out. This is curious. What's doing that? Oh my god. This is crazy. Okay, so that didn't help. And it's doing it for everything. I just need to hook in to where it's killing the light. What is it? What is actually killing the light? Yeah, it did. It is too. That's such a clue too. It's like, why is it making that fire lit sound? Yeah, that's a good point. Let's do that. Let's focus on that fire lit sound. Maybe that'll give a big clue. So, the fire lit sound. I think it might just be fire.wave. No, it's not fire. It's might be fire lit. Fire ignite, there it is. Yeah, it's fire ignite. Okay, so what is playing fire ignite? You've anchored the fire cost. Yeah, Jib's probably a virgin. Sacrifice him. So there's common ignite and fire ignite. So I'll just go to the profile. When it plays the sound, and then say if it's ignite. Let's find out where the hell this is coming from. It just started happening today. I did some stuff with the story system this morning. Behavior? Oh, I also did the... Oh, I did some stuff with AI. AI components. So what entity is this? Behave. E. Play. Sound ignite. Some entity is actually playing ignite. What entity is this? It's just a fire entity. What? Oh. Okay, I think I know what's going on. That all the flames, I think they're all getting AI. Oh, yeah. Okay. So some entities, even though they might have a profile named Fire, they shouldn't be loading the Fire's AI. In fact, maybe I should just take the AI off of the Fire. Does the Fire have an AI? By default. Oh, no, it doesn't. It does. It does. Okay. So, yeah, we don't want to give things a behavior. We don't want to just give something to have a profile fire and then get its behavior from the profile. You could take the fire out of the AI, but not the AI out of the fire. What entities are doing this? It has the profile fire. Profile fire? Here's one. The zero light is probably it. Is there anything else that's profile fire? I don't think so. I think it's just this one. Okay, so if I take that out, it lost its animation. But at least they have, yeah, at least the AIs didn't kill it. Okay, that's the problem. All right, so these guys don't need the AI from this fire. And it's just due to some new stuff I added to the AI components so that they can load AI if they want to. I'm just going to copy him from fire. It's not a big deal. Just got two sounds. All right, so now we have a more powerful entity. Whoops, we need the animation too. Okay, well, Actually, it's probably better to make a specific fire entity for living fire. Fire that's alive. Fire that's supposed to die after a minute. So I should find the places that are spawning fire or creating fire. This spawn, the fire boss spawns some fire. What should I call this? Fire that's alive after it dies after a minute. So like fire living, fire alive. Fire living, I guess. I don't know. Smart fire? There you go. Smart fire. Smart fire. Cool, that works. Burning. The burning nation. Data entities. I think this is where it's at. No, it's not. Where is it? It's a weapon. Let's call it Fire Smart just to keep it camel case. Wait, what's that called where you put the word first? Fire this, fire that, just to keep them alphabetical or whatever. I don't know. Fire text, Fire Smart. And then move the fire to just an entity. Okay, there. So now when we spawn fire, we want to spawn Fire Smart. Same thing here with the fire trail. Yeah, spawn Fire Smart. Let's see if there's any other usages of spawn fire. Nope. But I think there's going to be some usages of just fire. This is where we spawn fire. Yeah, there's some special logic for spawning fire a little bit randomly. This is gonna be Fire Smart. Not there, not there, not there. Wait, where does that, there's a, apply elements. Where it could create some fire. Oh, there, it's a function called create fire. Auto entity light. We want to do a fire smart here. But what's the difference between this and light? Zero light. Fire Smart has all these children too, right? Children oval, children additive, render, particles. Oh, it has everything except for particles. this one has a collision as well. Fire, regular fire, doesn't need any of that stuff. No render, no require valid, no input, no children, none of this. It's just animations and sounds. That's regular fire. And fire smart is that. Okay, so this needs to create a fire smart entity. Shot neutral, filter fire. Flags, no chain. I think that's right. Yeah. Okay. So auto entity, fire smart, base pause, light offset. Already got the damaging collision entity. Just want to do make sure it has a collision component. And set its damage. All right, Boogie. See you, buddy. I just typed BC Woogie. I'm leaving it. I'm leaving it. Okay, now I gotta check all this, make sure I didn't break any all the fire. There needs to be a BC Woogie. Alright, good. So these flames haven't died. Must I kill them? Good. That story action's taking a little bit long. Let's dial that in a little bit. So delay, scan. Okay, let's make sure we can just like if use get the fire blink, that'd be a good thing to have for this to ignite some things. Let's go to the overworld. Somewhere random. Fire blink. Blink fire or fire blink? I don't remember. There's no trees here. There we go. I can give you hurt by it. Good. Oh, but it flickered weird at the end. Oh, probably because it has its own AI already. It deletes itself. So it doesn't really need to remove its light. Pretty sure it does. Fire smart. Sequence initial timer. Okay, we should probably set its timer. What were these parameters? Remove light 2.2 over 1 second. Is that a delay and then duration? Delay, yeah, delay duration. Delay. Killed myself with my own fire. Because it's shot well. Anyways, I think this is good enough for now. Probably need to check that some more, but I think I want to start this sound effect before the stream is out. How long have we been streaming? Oh my god, 2 hours, 20 minutes already? Okay, never mind. Never mind. Alright. Well, that's going to be it for today's stream. I'm going to go see this one scene one last time, though. So, let's go to this room and see the scan effect. Yeah, it could be made of an ally or a foe. It's meant to be a neutral, though, so it doesn't really have a side. But yeah, it could be made either way. Oh, I see what you're saying, like not being able to be hurt by your own fire. There's some other code in there that's meant to like protect you from your own fire. So... I'll work on that. I'll work on it before I check all this in. So, anyways, that looked pretty good. The scan looks pretty good, but I just gotta make it the sound effect really good now too, so. Yep. Dinner time, and then I'll come back and make that sound effect. So, thanks for watching, everybody. Thanks for all your suggestions and the help with the math. I can't do math. So, yep, we'll see y'all next time.